Okay.
Hey, this is class. Alright, I'll see you guys later.
Hey, you're leaving early today? You're missing in 2 weeks. You're missing the 25th.
I'm missing the whole month.
No, you're missing my 25th.
Oh, yeah.
Alright.
Yeah.
I have an emergency. Gotta get my whip and go with the guys. No, I'm kidding. I don't think that's legal.
Nice heavy pen.
What?
Hold on to it.
Whipping your employees.
Thank you, sir.
With all this statement.
I was going to comment on that.
With all the state laws and regulations, not like the good old days, man.
When I was in college, I was working as a cook, and I told the two kids, high school kids, full house, a whole bus sitting out there, okay? Put food on the counter. And I was sitting there and warming them. And I just said, move it. And they complained about the attitude.
Did you hear about the coach that got fired for using the F word to the students?
Hey, I'm sure the F word.
I'm not commenting.
The F word at the students.
When I was in school, that was like the sports.
They want me to do that.
What did you get, Doctor? I'm having for breakfast, man.
Anybody else? We missing?
Bagel.
Bagel. I'm gonna run to the cafeteria and get me a sandwich. I'm starving.
Oh man.
Doctor Ferg and then we're at home this morning.
Oh yeah.
We need to break it out.
to land use planning and project design, or as I call it short, site planning, and following to the book. What we're going to do today is we're going to play a little bit more of urban planning, urban plan, the game setup. We're introducing that predefined spreadsheet, which is a little bit simplified and also a little bit complex. So we're going to dedicate most of the afternoon for this, because you're now looking more and more into a box that constrains you and boxes you more in. And this part of today's session is also like the idea of perspective, how space is perceived, and that box constraint comes from description and by financials. Yeah? We will see a little bit more and more how this goes downhill. And you can see in your groups, if you have now an idea, now the site planner talks versus the community liaison guy or gal, then you will realize this is not the way we can do things. And if you looked at the video from last time or shared pictures in your groups, you realize that last time we built pretty much freestyle with those blocks, just to get acquainted with the type of buildings, basic type of buildings, and then the gentleman over there and that one group, they just started with green rooftops, completely compact design, and then once in a while I stopped by that group and said, hey, by the way, now you reserve the shelter, and damn, everyone really loved me for that. But it shows you that if you are in a real world project team, that you can walk in into a room, into a meeting, and suddenly something completely explodes on you, in your face, bails out on you, and the whole structure is completely gone. You ever heard about prototyping in the industry, particular automobile industry? I used to have a friend, I still have a friend, he's a deep temperature physicist, but he ended up actually building car seats for Audi, if I remember right. Was a brand, Audi or Volkswagen. And they built for months prototypes on car seating heats and how you manage the whole technology in that car seat. CEO of the board walks in, sits down, says, I don't like it, scratch the whole project from start over again. So that little tiny stunt we did last week with, hey, let's change just a little bit the constraints, that's real life. Yeah? What if you have a planning and zoning commission meeting and suddenly you have new setbacks and other regulations coming in, or national environmental regulations you need to consider? All right. So the rough plan for today, yes, there will be lunch. This time I didn't put it up on there. Quick check-in, see how you guys are doing, where you're struggling with this class at this point. I doubt it, but let's see. The readings should be pretty forward. Take notes. Really take notes. That's the best way to remember what you read. And we're doing lectures parallel to lectures chapter 5 and 6. I have about 7 or 8 pages of notes today, and I have parallel around some PowerPoint slides for visuals. Those pictures in the book are black and white and really bad quality, so I pulled a few examples from the real world just to give you a better illustration on what's going on. Yeah? And the idea again is, think about outside of the box, think about context, particularly when we talk texture, that one section in the book, when we talk about pavement textures or facade textures, how that impacts the whole topics, sound, light, noise, feeling of that space. And remember, if you create a feeling of a space, what do? You create places. Yeah? Yeah. So technically, this whole, therefore destination, so the whole, basically chapter 5 and 6 is about the environment and the perception of a place you create, a space you transform. Yeah? And one of the best examples for that are theme parks. There's a whole discipline that studies theme parks, like geography of theme parks. Yeah? Starts with the wading snakes in Walt Disneyland. Yeah? Starts with how you structure places and how you walk in. There's, today we talk about the gateway function. I have 2 or 3 slides for that, just to give you an idea.
What language is that? Like theme parks? Is it, like, what is it?
everywhere. That's literally, there's an academic discipline that talks about the geography of theme parks.
I think that's what classified here.
Like zoning, what is it, zoning? Like, because I'm like...
Open space.
Hopefully not. I honestly don't know. This could be some simple chess. I would think commercial, because it's a commercial entity running the roller coaster. Special use.
Oh,
yeah. Would be interesting to check the Orlando comprehensive planning, plan in general, or other plans across the nation,
Where
how they plan that.
Yeah, I'm gonna look that up.
Biotechnology parks are industrial. Yeah. Then there's, you have typically the R&D park, which is a combination of industrial, manufacturing, and office, its own category. Depending again on the state and the zoning code there.
Okay.
But good question. And then what I want to do is the, but mostly in the afternoon, is exploring the real estate functions in the urban plan. Let's take apart those legal blocks and put our thoughts together how that actually reflects real estate development. Yeah. Be a little bit critical about it, particularly when we take a look at that Excel spreadsheet. So I put the Excel spreadsheet up on Blackboard. We have at least, can you open Excel? Yeah, on your Mac. So we have enough computers here. Might have one student actually running the show here, because we need to work on this. I want everyone in the team, doesn't matter if you're a financial analyst role, I want everyone playing with that Excel spreadsheet. If for some reason you don't get the time or late time today, you gotta do this as part of teamwork. Yeah? So you really understand if you tweak the square footage in one block, how that fits into the whole comprehensive view of the whole project. Yeah? So as part of the teamwork is not just your financial analyst is dealing with it. Your financial analyst is the guy or girl that makes the judgment call on it. And if you look at that spreadsheet later on, it's interesting because it's kind of an optimization problem. If you're moving away from aesthetics and how this will look like in terms of building height and arrangements, you basically write a minimization or maximization objective. Maximize the profit, and then one of the constraints would be complete each community group's limitations. And you find this. Remember we talked about this chips and French fries problem? Chips. How many chips and how many French fries you can have for $20? Yeah. So in here, this is what we call in optimization modeling a solution space. Therefore, if you suddenly say, hey, wait a minute, for some reason, you're only allowed to buy the maximum of these kind of chips and no more or further, yeah, that's forbidden. That is now your new solution space. So what we do step by step is you add the community to it. Let's move away from French fries and chips. You add the community to it, maybe like this, because that's very simplistic way to think about this. What are your limitations? Like, think about this like a boundary. Like, who has a dog? Do you have a dog with a electronic collar, like electric fence?
No.
That's cruel.
That is cruel.
Well, but think about this. This is kind of the imaginary line you can't cross. Yeah. Or if this would be your bank account, there's zero money in your bank account and you cannot take out credit. Yeah, and then you're forced to save money or stop spending it. Yeah? Or think about it, you have family dinner and you only have 8 plates, but 10 people come. So you have a problem here. Yeah? So, but again, typical way, this is called linear constraints. The typical way of this is you have a certain budget and it limits you. And if you add another limitation to it, and another limitation, and another limitation, that solution space gets smaller and smaller and smaller. In organization theory, you know, you do those Venn diagrams, like A and B, and this is where A and B overlap, so this is where they agree with each other. Yeah? What if you have a third party coming in, and this guy is very strict? That's how a real estate developer and says, I'm only going to do this part here. So this is basically your solution space between those three parties. In land use planning, or in planning in general, we call it consensus to some extent. This is where people will agree upon to make that decision. Yeah? That's why you sit down with people on the call and communicate. Because you might end up just at that edge, at that point, rather than in the middle. All of that is possible. Yeah? So solution space, consensus building. Again, there's a huge mountain of literature that deals particularly about the dynamics of decision making and consensus building. The whole concept that you have by constitutional law, amendments 14 and 5, that you have these due processes, that you have to post a rezoning application in the public on the site and a newspaper, and you have to invite people, and you have basically a checklist of everything you need to do. That is part of that as well. Because if you don't, you can say, hey, we didn't reach that official agreement. No? So that's what we're going to do, particularly in the afternoon, taking a look at the spreadsheet and how it relates to urban plan and how it relates to our team setup, the roles we take, and then to our own creativity inside those teams. Because at the end of today, you need to make a decision as part of like a brainstorming idea of what is your vision and your kind of a direction or directive for your team. Because you probably will not be able to fulfill all the constraints. Some what you have to drop off, and some you just have to say, oh, let's write off, we can do this. Yeah? Let's say a homeless shelter. One team might say, hey, we're going to keep it, and one team says, we're going to factor the cost. So, dynamic, flexible, which is always a challenge for learning experiences because you don't know what the guy in front of you wants. So, bear with me here. This is do it over and over again. Do it once, do it twice, do it three times, do it four times, and you realize, hey, there is actually really a learning in it. Like playing with Legos. Sometimes it doesn't work out. Alright.
We have an exam next week.
Oh, you want to take that fun out of right now?
No.
Oh, okay. So we have a Tuesday night class, and I need to talk to the Tuesday night instructor, but we probably have completely different, we have a different style of doing this. So the plan was we will have, in a grading structure, we will have the midterm, which is an essay-based questions, short questions. I've been contemplating about how many questions and what's the setup.
One.
One?
Yeah.
I can give you one question, 2 hours of time writing on it. So what I want to do is, I will give you
options,
which is tricky sometimes. Yeah. An hour to 90 minutes time to get it done, depending on the amount of questions. At a minimum, three questions covering what we have heard in lectures and in the text. So if you look at this, we are finishing with chapter 6 today. There are three blocks of sessions that combine chapters, so you could expect one of each lessons. But then we introduced urban plan. We had a very interesting discussion about, let's say, what is the vision? Yeah. So I do repeat a few buzzwords in here, so you should have an idea of what does this mean. We had an assignment in two pieces besides the design, so you need to understand that a little bit. So typically in classes like this, what I would do is I would give two or three main questions that are mandatory, and I would give you a two or three other questions from which you pick one or two. That's a classic setup for essays. Yeah? And then you usually have like a short two lines of question on top of a piece of paper, and I give you the front and the back of that paper to answer it, handwritten. Handwritten because if you use technology in the classroom, I'm going to sit in the back. The moment you change your screen from a word processing software, I consider it plagiarism and cheating. So pencil, pen, paper. It's a little bit difficult to handwrite. I completely understand we're in the 21st century. But it's the best and the fairest way to assess that grade point for you. If you have issues, medical issues, on handwriting, please let me know in private. Send me an email, we will find a way to accommodate that. I had in the past students who have been brilliant, but had
disability.
Not disability, but a somewhat deficiency, a handicap, whatever you want to call it. They had brilliant minds, but they have been very slow in processing it into written language. And therefore, in this case, we gave those two students double the time. You know? Separate setup, testing center, and or my office. You know? So please, if you have anything in that direction, issues with your handwriting, besides I can't read it, if you, like, in speed, let me know. This is not a problem, per se. Don't be scared. We all have done handwritten tests. Got to write a little bit, but I also think handwritten, this is how I write my notes, so this is a page handwritten basically, so maybe twice, that's the complete answer for half a chapter of work. I'm looking not for a thriller or a 500 page answer, short essay questions like we have done in the online quizzes. Some will just look it, some will like that, don't need that, precise, concise, to the point. Again, I'm not going to use this probably, but if I ask you what is real estate development, we had that in the online class. What if you have to explain it? What is real estate development in your own words? Five sentences, really nice, maybe 10. Bring it to the point. So I'm not 100% sure yet how many questions. I need to double check the timing. I always sit down and do those tests myself before I lock them in. That's the reason I haven't had the time yet to get this done. I will give you five sample questions. Could be simple as, what is real estate development? Explain in 5 to 10 sentences. Who had not yet have my online class? You and you. Okay, fine. But this is kind of the pattern. Short, precise. It will be no notes, no open books, no other support than your writing utensils on paper. But that also means, take your notes, read up on them. I put the PowerPoints selected, not all of them, so what I put up on Blackboard, that is somewhat relevant. As of last night at 10 p.m., only two students accessed week one. I put week two on it yesterday night. So please do that and look up and do it starting this weekend. Don't do it Friday night before the class. Take a look at the PowerPoint slides again. And remember, hey, what this guy in front of you talked about. No, I put them on Blackboard. I put it on Blackboard, and that's actually, that's statistics tracking behind it.
Right.
So if someone completely bails out on the grade, I can ask you, hey, what happened with your preparation in the worst case? Don't want to go this way, but I had that way actually once. Hi.
Two questions. You mentioned online quizzes. You're referring to the marketing class, right?
Oh, yeah.
I remember
question style ask.
Like
in the other classes.
Quizzes?
Like back in time, the way I ask you questions.
You guys
okay? Like I had in the classes you had before with me. This is kind of the style I will ask.
Okay. You mentioned we'll have optional questions. Now, if we answered all of them, would you pick the best out of all of them?
You know how I do this? Back then, in planning theory, I would give students three mandatory and then pick two out of three. Two out of fingers. That's I'm European. So two out of three. With the comment, you need to tell me which one I need to grade. So you got check boxes and it's an A, B, C. Because if you say grade A and C, but you answered A and B, I'm giving you 0 points on C because you told me you won't get points. You want to get points on C. So yeah, I have to see. It's probably going to be. It's not going to break your neck, but you gotta sit down, put some effort in reading your text. If you haven't done so, start now. Yeah. Gotta have an understanding what Lynch is talking about or what we're talking about here. I don't ask a specific number. Yeah? I don't want to know what's the six, five digits behind the period point of the number pi. I don't want that. I don't ask you how old that book is. I want you to understand what are the important criteria when you come to the concept of site planning. Yeah? So when we talk today about texture, noise, and climate, you should have a comprehensive understanding on what is this about and how does this relate to A, to your site, and B, to your community and to your region. Those are the two major scales we have been addressing all the time. We talked about regional circulations with interstates and larger blocks, bam, and we talked about pedestrian movements on the site. So, local, site, and its context, up to the region. We're not going to ask state regulations or something. Alright? Precise to the point, I give you a few sample questions in the next few days so you can sit down and practice. Most of these essay short test questions, the scary part is that you not have had the experience to sit down for 10-15 minutes and answer one question. Important thing, if you do these questions, samples, spend a minute or two on brainstorming. And this is, can be simply done as in, if this is the page, and here is the question text. Old school, take a corner here, and write your keywords down. What do you think needs to be in that answer? And then you start writing, wipe this out. Start writing, wipe this out. And at the end, you get full points. Because the worst thing, even if it's for 10 minutes thinking about it, in 10 minutes writing, what is real estate development? Think about it, write it, formulate full sentences. Yeah? And oops, I just forgot this keyboard. Because you have been concentrating on how to write it and how to write it in a readable way, because if I can't read it, I can't give you points for it. That comes from a guy who has a terrible handwriting. Yeah? And I will give you instructions. They'll be on the instructions via email first and then on the exam. We do have a fair amount of folks in this room, including me, with second or third language English. But we got to maintain some level of well English, good written, or good English well written, actually. You know, if your grammar completely goes downhill, yeah. But if your language is completely out of space, you got to find a way on that. I have no problems to give you a point or 2 points deduction because you cannot express a short answer in a precise way. Think about, you need to write an executive summary in your job to your boss and bosses, to the board, to the council members, so they know why you're putting $12 million into the ground in their community. Yeah? So a little bit on that, I can be a little bit picky. But again, short answers, handwritten essay, not completely crazy about that. If you, since we have this discussion, if you write a word, just let's say test, and for some reason you have a spelling error, don't take the rubber pen thing or eraser. Just wipe it out and write it again. That's the safest way to save time. You will have enough time, again, for those who have stress, elevated stress levels about testing. I wouldn't ask you to do that if I would not know that you can do it. Okay? This is part of the graduate student program. We need to have, for this class and any class, you need to have individual grades. I just can't say everyone is group-based tested. No? So put the effort in it, make that solid. Does this answer your question?
Yeah, thank you.
My plan is to start the test on time. I know there's a transition. Yeah? At the latest at 10:30, that test starts. At the latest. I prefer actually 10:15, which is, I don't want to give too much class time away. I have to figure out how to deal with late arrivals. Because after that, we take a quick break and I mean, go straight into the class program. Yeah? And you also need to check with Dr. Foggy about those regulations here at NSU in terms of testing environment. Yeah? I prefer to start in the morning of the test to get all the anxiety away. Yeah? So everyone can take a deep breath, bathroom break, go outside of the building, yell yeehaw or I hate this guy, and then come back, refresh minds, and we are happy and we can do some learning. Okay? Got that?
So it's going to be a written test. You wouldn't put it in a blackboard form.
No, I bring paper print out.
Okay.
The preferable stable. We need to figure that out how to do this with the current printer system. But I'm going to provide all the paper and material. If you choose to have like a half a page additional paper, you're fine. But I should. There's enough space available to answer these questions, unless you write that thick on a piece of paper. If you write a normal handwriting, and I know some of you just do capital letters versus cursive, it's a huge, or print, yeah, that's fine. I calculate the time for this exam as you would print with pencil. Huh? That also means I can read it in a fast way. In 12 years in the US teaching or being in classes, I only had two times a student where I told the student, I cannot read your handwriting. I will be not able to give you points on this. Let's talk about it. On one question, you got 0 points for handwriting. The other question, we had a conversation about it, and I gave him 50%. Yeah? Well, that was a very interesting situation. Yeah? So I usually can read handwriting. Usually can. I have to put it on the exam and say, hey, if I can't read it, I will not be able to give you points. All right, is this answering your question? Is this putting up all the fears or are the fears away? Are you okay with this? Okay, can you give me a smile? Good. Yeah, this is gonna be not a super easy way, but not a super difficult way. It's gonna be a good way. If you listen what we talk about and discuss in this classroom, and if you have done the readings, absolutely fine. Print out the PowerPoints and make notes over those PowerPoints and you're fine. Well, then I think I did print the PowerPoints in the wrong format. I think one slide per page, probably two. I can change that. So you have two slides on one piece of paper. Saves the tree and it's more condensed. Good. Any other thoughts? Any other things we need to discuss as part of check-in? Yes.
What about grading the previous assignment?
Not done yet. And this is untypical for me. Usually, you have seen this in other classes. I'm very quick in turnarounds. Please forgive me. I will try to get the final grades done within the next few days. I fly out on tomorrow afternoon for 10, 12 hours in a plane. Monday, get the last things on my house. Tuesday, the movers are there. Thursday, I'm back in town. And then, if not until Thursday, I will finish those grades. You need to see those grades and get feedback on your assignment before we have this exam. On that note, everyone was doing fine. We had a discussion in class. There was nothing to complain about or you two have seen the video maybe?
I did.
Yeah, so this is a wonderful example of, hey, they did an outstanding job, on the graphics component and the verbal explanations. So I need to double check the last written words on that, but it shouldn't be a problem. It's just a time delay because my life is in transition between 3,000 miles. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I hope you understand that. Yes.
Our groups seem to be like dwindling as far as the project's concerned. Do you know if there's people who have dropped the course? I know I didn't come last semester, but I mean last class.
Well, I have
last semester.
Well, the only person who dropped is Alex.
Excuse me.
Alex is in a group.
Yeah, Marinella is
out
today.
Okay.
And Kyle is out today for personal.
So the group sizes are the same?
Oh,
it's
about 5, 6, 6.
We've been pretty, like last week we were pretty organized. We have it together. We haven't sent an email. The only person who's not in the group anymore is Alex. So it's just
the same
group minus
who's
one.
Who's Alex?
Alexandra.
Alexandra Hall.
Alexandra
Hall, the one that's fighting.
But she's
young.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah, we did.
So no, the groups are fine. Class size, it's up and down, but it's okay. They're all still on the books.
The entire class period last time, he had us doing, playing with it and making this scenario.
Yeah.
So it wasn't that's our serious plan. I have pictures of it and stuff that I can send.
So this part of the afternoon group work to catch you up. And then what we also did is last time we had at the end we had about 10 minutes for each group to show off and present what they have done and why they did things, just to have a comparison as part of learning curve. Yeah. Again, you do have two teams, but there's an overlap on what you need to learn from each other, and then there's this individual component at the end, which group could be better, the competition. All right, let me catch up. Oh, yeah.
Did Charlene call you? Is she coming today?
I don't know. Communication for the team, you guys need to be tight on that. I don't know if she's coming late. We'll see. All right, visual form, chapter 5. The important thoughts, and this is kind of somewhat paraphrasing from the book, clarity, meaning, senselessness, stimulus, pleasure, and disgust. There are more examples in it, but the stimulus and disgust of space and places, I think, is important to understand. And the way we can say this is, you walk into a perfect hotel room, and you're like, great. Yeah? Like, wow.
Never happened? Something wrong.
No. I'm telling you, if someone is booking a hotel room for you and you walk into a room and you did not expect a suite, you will have that experience.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Example for disgust.
Dubai.
You walk into a room and you feel disgust.
If it's dirty.
If it's really dirty. The best example is you're at a rock concert and you walk into the bathrooms. So the luxury suite versus bathroom. Nope, I'm going to the other place. Yeah. So, but it is important to understand that the perception with all the senses we have, even the written ones, is important how to construct spaces and places, therefore. Yeah? So we're not talking about greenfield development. Think about we're now on a level of how would you arrange objects on that side. And then also how much detail would you put in there? And how close would you arrange, let's say, residential buildings versus how far away? Because that gives you a little bit of a different concept of the space. And Lynch, follow pretty strictly today the book, Lynch talks a little bit about the movement here, sensuous function in combination to circulation. Because if I enter a subdivision or some space, a commercial mall, by car, by foot, or by bike, that gateway and that perception of that space, entering that space, will be different. Yeah?
Curb appeal.
So, yeah, a residential single family housing, we call that curb appeal. Yeah? That's the reason why you put 15 bags of mulch onto your front yard. Yeah, just to have that perfect picture taken for the photography there. Because nobody else wants to watch the house there. So, but the interesting thing here as well is he talks about the landscape of the Western culture and brings it in this example, living room versus site plan. Again, scale. For the context of this class, site versus region, the living room is just an example. We could rearrange this room 5 times, and we would have a different appeal to that. If you put tables together as islands, it's better for group dynamics. Yeah? This is the most stereotyped lecturing hall setup. If I just walk around the room right now, and yeah, I don't have the remote in there, but I could lecture all afternoon from here. Now the perception and the learning experience for you is somewhat hindersome, because everyone now turns around and doesn't really look anymore to the front. So right now the delivery mode for me is to show you guys that the knowledge transfer is combined visually and audio. Yeah? So I try to streamline that process. What does Kevin Lynch mean with that quote here? In contrast to architectural space, sized space is much larger in extent and looser in form. How would you explain it to someone? What's the meaning of this?
Well, you could stand inside a building or outside a building and see the architectural design and details of it versus a large parcel of land that's, you know, there's not that much detail. It could be just farmland or such.
Okay. Good. And what else? Do we need to deal with architectural details when we talk about the general site plan? When we talk about the arrangement of functions and the synergies on the site, do we need to deal at that point already with that architectural interior?
Yeah.
Well, it needs to be coherent and it needs to relate to one another. Yeah.
On the conceptual phase, are you making a judgment call if you rearrange, let's say, a small commercial office versus residential units on a site and try to figure out where do you put the stormwater overflow versus the roads circulation? Are you already thinking about red bricks versus siding?
I'm trying to.
All right.
I mean, that's where everything's going with all the green and lean design.
All right. So again, 60-year-old book, 70-year-old book. So my contrast today is in visuals is he's talking about a few things that are impossible or should not be done, and then the picture is like, eh, yeah, I told you so. So, but the more complex and more detailed, the more detailed you think, the more complex you get. Yeah? So right now, at that level, the idea is we're going into those details. But was the last session when we talked about the arrangement of uses? And there's this one sketch actually in a book that almost looks like this. And at the end, like residential, office, and retail. And at the end, it's more like a nicely set up, arranged because of the linkages of these uses. Yeah? So when you rearrange these, there's a whole chapter or section in those chapters about linking those uses. And then that also goes into the idea of circulation. How, if this would be now a residential part, how would you actually connect walking paths, etc.? Which goes into the whole problem of patterns. Yeah? And I can post one or two more pictures on Blackboard from a different book that shows how scale impacts patterns, like neighborhood street, cul-de-sac, neighborhood street, arterial road, up to the level of interstate. Yeah? And what is the daily load on these in terms of capacity? Because the whole idea about system thinking and circulation was that you move things. Electricity, water, people, cars. Yeah? Again, I'm not talking about the exact number of that pathway or how big that street needs to be and how well you need to construct it in terms of your cost factor. I'm talking about the concept of, do you need this one, or are you presenting a more sustainable way and say, hey, on this side, there's only pedestrian and bicycle path, and parking is just behind it. If you want to go to this building, only delivery can be done or handicap access. Everyone else who is able to walk, walks. And I like this campus feeling if you do a university. Alright, so a little bit more about the use of materials as the advantage to improve the site. And I mentioned last week one or two architects which I think have been very impressive across the world with their work, and we actually are a reverse design example when we did the Google Earth flyover. Some of you asked me, hey, what's that building in the back? We're talking about an architect in a minute. So the spatial dimension are reinforced by light, color, texture, and detail. And this is where architectural ideas come in, urban design come in. And
Hi. I'm starting in the fall. Just wanted to say
any months.
Oh, good.
We collect tuition over here. So
yeah.
That's new to me. Alright, let's talk about that in a break.
Alright.
I wanted to present you guys some visual extremes, particularly when it comes to light, color, texture, and detail. And that's the idea of this parallel lecture today. Parallel to notes, I have a few slides where I say, okay, fine, let's take a look at this. Yeah. One example here is the spaces differ in character according to their intrinsic proportions. Yeah. And there's this little tiny sketch on a small room versus an empty room versus a room filled. And then in the book, he has this example of when do you see a person? And what's the dimension to that person? Yeah. So the examples are 4,000 feet. You can see that there's a person standing. Then 80 feet, you have a recognition on the person. And then within that from 45 feet, you actually have the face. Yeah. And then you have your face to face. You have that very personal, intimate moment where you decide to run away or hug. Yeah. But the idea is, okay, perspective and distance. This is how we construct spaces as well. In terms of site planning, are we talking more about a square, a rectangle, or a very long rectangle, or something completely off shape because we follow, let's say, a coastline, or we follow a river, yeah? And we have to follow certain buffer zones in that. So the idea right now, later on, is the kind of the concept of spaces and barriers. So I want to do a little bit in abstract here on poodle list. Any idea what I mean with poodle list? It's totally brutal. Who has an architectural or an interior design background?
Design designs.
So poodle list. There are certain ideas of poodle list. One is the architectural era of let's use concrete to build everything we can build. Different examples across the world. One of the most brutal, architectural achievements have been, let's say, in Europe, particularly in Germany, after World War II, because war was kind of a redevelopment machinery for towns, because they bombed out, burned down, and you use concrete to rebuild. So you have in certain towns in Germany now, you have wonderful, beautiful, historical buildings, and right next to it, a concrete parking garage that hasn't seen any greening or screening in decades. Maybe now the last 10, because people get angry with this. But poodle list is also the idea of the deconstruction of existing space with new architecture. Any idea what that is?
Office building.
That is an office building. That looks like a bank because it looks like a fortress. Federal building is good. It's probably the federal building. It's located in Washington, D.C. It's called the Edgar Hoover Building. FBI headquarters.
Oh, that's what it looks like.
looks really intimidating, yeah? Like really brutal.
I said it was the deconstruction of
existing space.
Of existing space. That's somewhat my definition on it. Because you look at it and you feel like
this
whoa,
is space with new design, right?
With new architecture. And material, particularly material. If this would be now glass and steel, gee, we would think this is in California, you know? Or nice and new, with green tops. But this is, the picture does not give that building the right emphasis. That is just a monster. When you walk around the corner, this is a high effect. Oh, it's a building you all seen on TV. Now you look at it, it's like, ooh. And you don't have to have anything going on around this. It's just the fact that it is intimidating. So when I was looking for other pictures,
it's pretty cool.
It's somewhat cool, but it's somewhat intimidating.
Muscular.
I was looking for other pictures, looking for like brutalist architecture. I found the CBE building in Calgary, Canada. For those who are into movies like RoboCop, the original one, that one of the police department buildings, that was a classic example of brutalism. A brutalist architecture. We have two or three examples in the book about how you place a building within a city or above a city. Temple in Lhasa, as an example, I have a picture on that in color, so you see this.
Just curious, have you seen the new FBI headquarters in Miramar?
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like a Star Wars. Spaceships, or whatever you call them.
We'll add it to the next lecture for it.
That's pretty cool.
Where's that located?
Turn up 75, just, what is that, south?
Do you know where
Pembroke
Gardens is?
Yes.
There's like a back road you can go down, it has a light map. So if you're going, what's that word, south?
Yes.
Yeah, if you're going south, like so when you come out of Pembroke Gardens, you don't go to Pines, you go right, and you go down, there's a huge glass building, your phone will like cut out to on your satellite radio, like that's what.
Oh, really?
Yes.
All right.
FBI building.
You can't miss it.
Can you repeat again what you just said? In both. The fact that you, how you describe that site, that building, the moment you pass the building, you sign
your
radio, you basically sign your radio, phone, etc. It's like a wow. Like, ah, yeah. Different architecture and different materials used.
Right.
Yeah? Compared to that, I'm thinking like really nice curves, bit tall building with a flat out, designed to depth, not just massive in front of you. Yeah? So remember what you guys did last week, blocking out those spaces and you put that super block in? Well, that was really cool, but however, what if you do a more low profile on the building rather than a super high rise, block style, yeah? Different ways. We had this group actually had gaps in it on purpose. You didn't build out completely. So okay, another example, visual example, and then basically, I mentioned Khan, not this guy, yeah, Star Trek 2 or 3, Wrath of Khan, yeah, old school. Probably only two people in this room have seen it in live theater. I'm not meaning this guy, I'm meaning this guy, Louis Kahn, born in Estonia, opened up an architectural office in Philadelphia, and at the end, I think he died in New York City. Brilliant guy. He learned, and this is why I put him up here on the slides, he learned that how space is sensed by vision. He demonstrated that. He moved concrete from a gray matter into some livable, acceptable space.
What's his first name?
Louis. Yeah. And his son, his illegitimate son, he had like an affair. The guy did actually a movie called My Architect. It's a story about Louis Kahn, and then besides a family story, it's a fantastic architectural movie. But the idea here is Kahn demonstrated in a fascinating way how light and shape and shade can construct better spaces. Yeah? On the next few slides are just visual examples to wow you away from use concrete as a ugly building slash parking structure versus you can be creative and can play with this. If you do do-it-yourself projects nowadays, you can buy actually concrete paint, like stain, and suddenly that craze, like a more rouge, red, your gardening looks different. So this is a photo shoot of him. The building you're looking at is the Yale University Library. That's a concrete ceiling. But with different lighting and sunlight coming in, you have this different effect. Then this one we had last time. Let's see if we can open this. Yeah, it's just Google search. So in the worst case, we put this computer likes me or not. This is the building we have seen last time. Bangladesh. And so this is where I think this is absolutely impressive, how the reflection of the water is dealt with the architecture. This is pure concrete. Part of the inside, natural light coming in.
And what's the function of that building again?
It's a parliament.
It's a parliament.
Federal administration building in Bangladesh. The Yatio Sangstad Baban. Remember we did the coloring example and we basically flew into that building?
Yeah.
So this is an aerial shot. You can see how patterns occur, how different shapes in the concrete wall make this a completely different experience. I don't know if they have parking. No, but if you look at the shape right now, this is a plaza. You have pedestrian access here. That looks like a tennis field almost. But you have open space, light coming in. You have additional office buildings around it. A completely different idea. I just can encourage you guys for 10, 15 minutes when you're sitting at home in the evening, reflecting this class. Just Google this guy and go through a bunch of his work, because I think it's, in my career, he's probably made one of the most, in terms of work with concrete, with the biggest impression. Then we have the other example, the Salk Institute in California, which everyone now wants to have an infinity pool. But if you look at this, this is concrete, a little bit of water, and a sunset off that side. All of that is concrete. Different patterns now, you have the reflection in there. It's down in California and San Diego.
Is this more of Khan's work?
That's one of the examples of Khan's work, yeah. And Louis Khan's approach to modernism was quite dignified and monumental.
Okay.
Yeah. But what I want to show this is as a part of the decision is Lynch talks about how we can use materials to improve the site. Light, sound, texture. Yeah? Concrete texture. Concrete with different facets and texture and shape. Looks different from a typical apartment building, does it?
Those are apartments.
No, it's actually a research institute. Yeah? But it does. I could think about apartments here. Actually, I've never been on that site, to be honest. I'm going to be in San Diego in 3 weeks, so I might take an Uber and just take real pictures and say, hey, I was here.
Mm-hmm.
One of the most impressive examples is this one. This is the Exeter Library. Let's see the building. The Phillips Exeter Academy Library. Concrete, it's inside, real sunlight coming through the roof. Yeah? And because of the variations of light and material, that looks like a place I really want to go and study. Yeah? And different shapes in here, you can see this, how the light is done, it's in the evening, sunlight is gone, yeah? Different angle. Fascinating to me. Yeah? I hope you guys can feel a little bit that spirit that this guy constructed buildings like this out of concrete, not just yesterday, but 50 years ago. When concrete was a brand new material, 50 or 60 years ago.
But isn't concrete like a heavy material? Concrete, isn't it like a heavy material to do like architectural stuff with?
Yeah. And it's probably also all of that is steel enforced.
Yeah.
So you're talking about massive,
right?
Massive construction.
I guess he had a good engineer do the calculation for him. There's no need.
Yeah, they usually did it by hand back then. Yeah, that's before computers had been in. Yeah.
Yes.
Just the idea of conceptualizing this and the structs we complain about today, and saying, okay, fine, let's actually move this into a different concept and build concrete. But this concrete. Remember I showed this picture from the French banlieues, the neighborhoods, like we would say, let's call the projects? Brutalist. Big block. Ugly block. By perception and coloring. Somewhere. Do you feel better about that space? Do you feel home in that space? No. But here, there's something going on that means, at least, I want to see this in real life. At least I want to go there once, you know? I said, you create a destination somewhere. Huh? So, let's get rid of this guy. And there we go. So, very quick introduction on Louis Kahn. More architectural, but I really like the fact that it fits perfectly into the textbook's storyline right now, how material can be used to improve a site. Take advantage of that. Yeah? And one of the advantages we will see in the next few minutes is that how spaces differ and how we add detail to them. We talked about textures, we talked about plants. Water, I didn't really present that. Water is in our daily lives here. How we have a flat surface versus a wobbling surface, how the sun is coming in different angles. But there's also the talk about albedo, but that is coming in a second. Spaces differ in character according to their intrinsic proportions. I mentioned it earlier. Space has scale. Scale in its existence and in its perception. Yeah? Space is a viewing point and it depends on distance, perception, and context. So one of the examples we had earlier, in I think session number one, I showed examples from all over the world. Remember that picture with that mosque and that design, very super large constructs. That is when you go beyond that typical proportion of scale versus human scale, and you supersize the building. Different architects did that, different cultures did that. The Nazis in Nazi Germany had their kind of idea of if we overscale it, then we supersize it, therefore we demonstrate power. Yeah? Alfred Speer was one of these architects. He presented Gropius, Gropiusstadt. Max Gropius is an architect who designed the Pan Am building, MetLife building now in Manhattan. Different type of architecture. Yeah? However, not to distract from here. Spaces vary in effect on by the way they are entered. That's the gateway function. Starts also with the door you open up. Ugly door versus nice door. Yeah? The hotel suite versus the bathroom stall. By their use. Are we talking about a functional multi-purpose room? Like the atrium outside? Or are we using this one? You could do a cocktail party in here, but outside, space is different. Yeah?
get.
Power.
No warning.
So excited about lecturing.
So if someone needs to go to the bathroom right now, this laptop probably takes a minute or two to reboot. Or we just lecture from the notes, one or the other. Let's do a quick bathroom break.
Look at that, man.
Did you lose your power?
Nah. This is not the worst of laptop.
That laptop is so
hard
to do a whole lecture.
Probably older than that big.
That was all planned. I literally have a timer going down here and saying, bathroom break. Give them one more minute and then we kick in. So the lunch, Quincy, lunch list is everything okay?
No, no, that's fine. I'm
okay. Yeah, we usually have an extra one or two for some reason. That's the reason, maybe not this time, but this time I actually wiped out the ones I knew for sure that were coming. All right. Jason takes a minute. Oh, that's okay. So spaces vary in effect. By the way they entered, that is the buzzword, or like say, bam, the light needs to go up for gateway function. Yeah? If you design spaces, we talk about gateway functions. That's the reason why we have these little tiny name blocks and a little bit of trees and vegetation on any subdivision you enter. Yeah? Like Alpine Woods, this one, vegetation. Nice, welcoming atmosphere. Create something about that. Then again, they differ and have different effects by their use. Residential versus commercial, enough said. Supermarket versus a single family home. However,
by daytime and night. Something he doesn't really mention in the book, but he talks about light. We need to understand that you create spaces and therefore places that feel different during the day and different during the night. Huh? The fact that we now have lightning plants, architectural lightning plants in terms of design, to actually show what kind of color settings you will have at 10 p.m. or at midnight or at 3 a.m. Yeah? That's important. In hotels, it's part of the brand recognition. Yeah, so you know definitely that's the Carlton Hotel or Ritz-Carlton in Singapore because it has this beautiful lightning setup. Empire State Building, you know, bam, this has a certain lightning depending on the political discussions we have. Yeah? Daytime and night also means parking structures. Yeah? During my daytime and parking structures, not necessarily a problem when we talk about architecture of fear. Or spaces of fear. In Europe, they started a few decades ago, good decade, if not 15 years ago, that we placed in parking structures women's dedicated parking spots close to the entry area and exit area. So you don't have to walk three floors up through a really dark space, parking garage, and get in trouble. Part of your own health and safety and the perception of such is to avoid proper lighting and placement of dedicated spaces that kind of add to that as a part of the commitment of fighting architecture or spaces of fear. That's actually an interesting book called Architecture of Fear by Nathan Allen, architectural and planning faculty in Utah. And part of that is actually talking about it. Next time you walk in the parking garage, like the structure we have here, take a look at it. Are there certain dedicated spaces? In theory, would you feel comfortable to walk into this garage at midnight? Huh? Any other space you look at next time, particular parking structures, best example is, does it commit to certain functions in daily life?
How is that enforced?
It's private property, you could enforce that easily with your parking management. If you have a dedicated family parking spots, you know, handicapped parking spots is easy. You know,
yeah.
That's a federal law.
Yeah.
You know? But if they have house rules and say you have dedicated, or state rules, you have dedicated parking spots in your parking structure for families. So you have a stroller and the bags and two kids on the hand. I appreciate that parking spot.
Yeah.
You know? If you don't have the kids with you, if you don't have a stroller with you, you know, the guy, you can park three floors up and walk. You know? So that's house rules. If it's private space, this whole discussion when we talk about planning versus real estate, you write the house rules. Planning, you argue, is that socially inclusive enough? You know? I'm all for that. I have no problems to give the first floor to dedicated parking for functions, gender, special situations. No problem with that. You make still make your revenues on the parking. That space is still $5 the hour or whatever rate you charge. Yeah. Simple example, if you do apartment buildings, you have resident parking, you have guest parking. Simple designation. Put a sign up, if someone parks as a guest in a reserved spot, bam, $400 total at your expense. Do that once or twice, you will never park in a reserved parking spot. Because you learn your lesson on a ticket. Huh? Again, the idea here with daytime and night is think about the proper lighting for these times. We're in Florida, we don't deal with snow, we deal with other hazards, you know? But we deal, if you go up north, we will see something interesting. Let's say Detroit Airport, very simple thing. Lights on the runway are on little posts. Because they can, then you know on the side, that's a foot or 2 foot high snow in the worst case, so you still can see the blinking lights. Yeah? If you go to the mountainous areas, you can see on the side, you see the posts that show how high the snow will go, so you have a level. But also they help you in winter with the snowblow to actually find the road rather than the trees and the posts. Yeah. So climate and topography specific signage and guidance in space is different. Yeah. And it has changed over the last years. As it is from industrial design and signage design, there's this whole emergence of how do we do better signage. In planning, we call that wayfinding. Yeah? The better you have signs up to find your way around, the less trouble you have with circulation. Believe it or not, we do that in theme parks as well. Our best example is this completely complex system, completely under control, how we manage our crowd control in our movements in the theme park. Yeah? If I put a one-way street for pedestrians traffic, most of the people will follow that rule. And suddenly I guide that flow of movements. If you have a roundabout versus a four-way stop sign, you will have different movement patterns. If you have red light for 2 minutes, good luck with that. Mm-hmm. All right. And then lastly, spaces vary by occupancy and vacancy. Again, this space here, this room, is occupied with people and furniture. Very simple abstract thinking. If I clear out that room, it looks different. It will vary in its effect. You walk in, it's like, oh, what are we going to do with this space? Versus, I put one table, one stool in this room, and you start thinking, how would I arrange this or rearrange this? And Jason probably will think how to change the tabletop already before he walks in. Detailed complex thinking. In terms of gateway functions, historic heart of San Diego, this is actually behind Hilton, this is not the gateway you see when you walk from the convention center from the bay. But they have basically in the historic area in the Gaslamp district this kind of gateway. Welcome! Now you are in our entertainment zone.
Huh? Yeah, right down the street there a few weeks ago. Yeah. Trump ride.
So, again, very simple function, simple piece of work creates a complete different perception of that space. By experience, you leave that convention center, you cross that very interesting intersection, and you walk like 20 feet and you see that other gate, and it's like, okay, fine, now I'm in the entertainment area, hotels, bars, restaurants, and I have 5 more blocks to walk to my hotel. Huh? Versus I'm with 15,000 people talking about jazz in the hallways behind me. Different function. You open up your mind in a different way. I found this sketch. That's a rendering because those people look really funny in terms of the illumination. That's a proposal for the Roosevelt Road Gateway Concept Street View Perspective Urban Design Placemaking Identifier Site Design Group. Found it, just Google gateway functions. Yeah? Would love to have a picture like this out of my own repertoire. But this is a completely different thing. This is like, ta-da! Like here, ta-da! Come here, enter us.
That's art.
That's art and gateway.
Right.
Yeah? Birds, okay. Yeah, well, that's just ambient part, but.
And
that? Ambience, yeah. But the interesting thing is, this is the signage. North Lawndale. This is how you will know this is the street or the neighborhood you enter. But it's also an old historic way to greet people into a room. Medieval ages, knights pull the sword, and then we call it the spalier. So you have the tip of the sword crossed, and people would walk underneath it. Yeah, you see that in traditional, in Europe you see that in traditional weddings, where the guards would cross the swords or sabers, and then the wedding couple would walk underneath it. Yeah? But that's kind of the same thing, like you heal the passage, yeah? And guard it. So different feel compared to this, yeah? Versus this. Okay, the width is different. Again, this whole rule about, remember the loser sign? Width of a street on the ground versus scale above. Take that look next time. Look at that street, you know. Next time you walk downtown, homework assignment. everyone, instead of a selfie, takes a picture, click, and submits it via Blackboard or email and put that up. And I gotta have a little bit fun. Next time you guys are out, day or night, take a picture of the street scale you're walking.
And then take a picture of you getting beat up.
No. you can tell if someone really wants to deal with that, you can tell them your professor said so. Lip says, space is sensed by vision. So all this part is now visual today. Sunlight, light, artificial light versus illumination. Space is sensed by hearing, which is interesting to do in a classroom, if you like, in front of each other, versus raise your voice and small. Then you go to the theater and opera, they talk quiet, they talk loud. You have in movie theaters, you have Dolby surrounds, THX systems. So Star Wars is not anymore visual, it's also a sound experience. That means we are not just hearing what happens in that space. We can construct that space as sound relevant. What do I mean with that?
Oh, like controlling echoes.
Reflection of sound, yes. Generation of sound.
Relaxing.
Absorption, okay. Containment of sound. Chapter 6 is all about that.
Mood.
Mood.
What are the
containment? Reflection, generation, containment, absorption. In retail psychology, if you cross those two elements, what are the two elements when you said mood? What are the common elements you try to deal with in retail? When it comes to your customers, you create physical space. There's a difference between the cereal bar down here versus the organic cereal bar up here, or the expensive sneakers in the corner versus the $500 boots on the podest right in front of you. But what else? What do you hear when you walk into your retail store?
Music.
Music. What kind of music?
Energy.
Depends on where you're walking in. What kind of music do you hear at the Apple Store?
High energy.
I don't know.
Most popular, mainstream. What do you hear usually in an elevator?
Relax.
Something slow.
Blues Brothers elevator music. What do you hear in an Urban Outfitter store or really jamming it?
That's like stuff.
It's one of
the latest. We don't even have a customized play track. It just played a local radio station.
Yeah.
But the funny thing is, it's all calculated. If you go here to the Whole Foods, it's jamming, isn't it? Depending on the daytime, you go in like, hey, yes, I'm in the mood. I'm going to get that food now. Huh? And then they have a commercial break somewhere and say Whole Foods Entertainment Radio or someone. Then you realize that this is program radio just for Whole Foods as a branch, if not for that store. Because it puts you in the mood. Different music, different moods.
Or depending on who's controlling the music that day, well, just put it high.
The sound, the volume is also important. If you're in a coffee shop and it's banging out of the speakers, it's not going to be that relaxing work environment anymore. I can't talk and communicate with you over a cup of coffee because it's so loud in here.
What kind of music does Walmart use today?
Good question. Next homework assignment.
The devil,
Today, you basically leave this class today and say, hey man, I played with Lego again, and I need to have like 5 experiences out in the real world. I've never been in a Walmart, so I need to go now and take the listening, not looking, listening what they play. I honestly don't know. I've never been to Walmart. I've been in Walmart, yeah.
I don't think they play music in Walmart.
Yeah, I don't remember what.
But then listen. If they don't play music, how do they guide the noise in that store?
There's usually a warehouse.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of like big.
Usually a warehouse, a huge,
but,
gargantuous warehouse.
Yeah, but I've been to one.
Oh.
And I just can't recall about the sounds there. Yeah. I think everyone was at Walmart once in a lifetime.
That's like DJs or Costco. They don't play music, but like it's not.
Yeah, but again, at Costco, it depends on how many people are there. There's different noises and different crowd sounds. Yeah. So when I say crowd sounds, it sounds like sauerkraut. But different crowd sounds. And that's ambient sound or white noise in someone. There are people who can't fall asleep anymore without music in the background. If you have kids, sometimes you just put on a fan, a box fan, so they hear this zzzz humming, so you can talk in the next room, otherwise they wouldn't actually pick up on that noise level. Yeah? So the different noise, sounds, and volumes of sounds, we need to be aware of. I have not explored the Nova campus yet to that extent, but some campuses actually have dead spots where the architectural design and the arrangement of the buildings creates a spot where you do not hear what you say. It's like you walk into a soundproof room, like into a radio station, and boom. I have no idea what you're saying right now, because I can't hear. It's gone. No? Fascinating, it drives you nuts. Particularly if you don't know what's happening. Again, space is sensed by hearing. So, space can be transformed into places when we have a felt value, culture, or identity. Today, we also learn the tools to transform that space, spaces into places, by vision, by sound, by material. Yeah? Let's go further. Ground four. Configuration of floor is determined by the pre-existing topography. Again, Lynch argues basically every type of topography is possible. In his small sketches, you can see actually really hillside stuff. That's the extreme case because you have to deal with slope, therefore creating of a property and the roads involved and your utilities are more complicated and more expensive. Yeah. And beginning of the lecture, we had our class session of the summer. We said a plan disrupts the site. So every action we will do on the site is somewhat an interference with that site and a disruption. Yeah? Now I said here, is there a message through design? Because just a simple picture of Louis Kahn showed you that we can present a completely different aspect of that feel on that site through design. Yeah? And I added here, and its modification, because with modern tools and explosives and other technology advances compared to the age of our textbook, we can actually now say, okay, fine, we actually just blow up that hill, paraphrasing here, and modify if cost for the modification is not a problem. Right? Or we integrate topography into the building and into the site. Vice versa, instead of trying to figure out how we put the building and the objects on the site. So it's more the kind of inclusive approach turns into a sustainable development, lead management, water management. If you built 25 years ago a building, I would bet money on it. Stormwater drainage, fine. Now you're more concerned about how you can keep the water, buffer the water on the site, and potentially even reuse the water if your legal framework would allow for that.
So on that same example, we're doing a project in Tampa, and the site is very small, like 1.5 acres. And there's a huge oak heritage tree there, and the city won't allow us to relocate or do anything with it. So we have to design an entire building around the tree. So what we did was create a little park, a little courtyard area with that tree in the center of the development. So it's pretty cool, it wraps the tree in it.
Yeah.
And we go up the green space.
The nature.
Yeah, the nature.
That's so cool.
And I think this is the right way to do. Yeah? If you get the right to develop that site, you should accept that constraint, that you respect the existing structure, And how old is that tree? 100, 150 years old? Yeah? But you, I think, this is part of this book. Respect the spirits of the site.
Here's my question.
Yeah?
I mean, forest fires, we can't control. So let's say a random little bit of night.
Well, it's awesome. That's a felony. And your company will run locked by itself when you're in prison. So we're not going to encourage that discussion. We're talking about natural systems.
Fires, though.
Go ahead.
They do control birds. I know they do a lot of this.
Yeah, you can do so-called prescribed birds. Yeah? But what he's telling is like, have 300,000 acres of burning fields.
You go to prison.
Yeah?
I will send you some new boys.
We are not, Emmanuel, we are not going into the creative site development aspects here. No, it's good enough that we make a joke about that. Yeah? But there have been certainly cases where suddenly buildings went down because of fire. Yeah? In Germany, we call it Warm Sanier, hot renovated.
A what?
Hot rehab. Burn it, the best way to rehab it is to burn it down without doing this. Yeah?
No, sure.
We can edit that out of the video recording.
Yeah.
So,
Canada just went through that.
Configuration of floor is determined by its existing topography. Keep that in mind. We talk about floor area ratio and coverage when we talk about development. What's better, a single-story house, a single-story building, 100% coverage, or we do four floors and therefore only have like some 25% coverage and create other space to be used. Depending on your density allowances and your regulations, you might be able to do that. And on your costs, because if you build higher, you're more expensive. The textbook has this guy in black and white. That's Lhasa. That's the temple in Lhasa. Which page was that?
Where is it?
Tibet.
Tibet.
Here, page 67. The expression of sight, the towering Potiala at Lhasa, and then Frank Lloyd Wright, great American architect, brought Eco City.
Yeah.
He built some fantastic buildings. That's the Magical Taliesin East in Wisconsin. That's actually a school, if I remember right.
That's a school.
School for what? Rich people.
Doesn't matter. It's just the fact that this looks more likely like a hillside mansion of someone who can afford to rent or
right.
live there. Yeah?
Yes.
But that doesn't matter. The socioeconomic fact of the person using the space doesn't matter. It's just about the integration of topography and vegetation. Like, if you Google this, you will see actually pictures where you barely see the roof line because it's completely embedded by existing trees.
Yeah,
huh? Versus this one, this is impressive, beautiful, towering over something. Yeah? Different concept. If this would be in a mid-Europe area, different scale, but you would say, hey, this is the king ruling over the people.
The city,
yeah?
That's how they used to be, like here on the walls.
Great pyramids. It's a burial site, but it has this massive, impressive character to it. Yeah. Abstract. Conceptual use of material in space towards topography and floor. Yes, please.
So the same concept apply for like the ancient civilizations that lived like within cave systems and like in mountain structures themselves?
I don't know my archaeology that well, but I would think that the technology advancement of the caveman living in cave systems is non-comparable to modern mason and tool use in places like this.
So there's a civilization that actually created, there's architecture within the cave system, not just holes in the wall they live.
Ah, okay, okay. So you mean like New Mexico carving into...
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Somewhat, on a different technical level, somewhat, yeah, where you create, if you don't have yet the ability to create brick or carve stone out of, like a quarry, but you have the material strong enough to carve into the hills, why not? I compare worldwide examples. So the city of Bamberg, B-A-M-E, Bamberg, Berg as a mountain or hill, has on top of the hill, among other things, the Catholic church, yeah, as a monastery. But what they also have, in, by concept, they drilled caves in here, all over the place, into the hill. Yeah. Well, now they call it the cellars. And stored beer over summertime there. Because if you go down into the mountain, the temperature will drop. Yeah? And it stay constant. That's the reason why you have wine cellars, not beer cellars.